Hello, darkness, my old friend. I've come to talk with you again. Because a vision softly creeping
feels bad, man.
People talking without speaking. People hearing without listening.
Hey guys, what's going on? It's Ash here coming at you today in Clash Royale. How you guys doing on the YouTuber challenge? Is my deck treating you all right? I hope so. I really like a lot of the decks in the challenge. I dislike a few of them too. I want to know what your favorite and what your least favorite is in the description below. I think my second favorite, of course, next to my deck would be the one with Sparky in it. I really like that. I think that's Kyo Kyo's deck. I'm a big fan of that one. Anyway, today we have on, it's funny, I brought on Anaban, called him the Mortar God, and he is a mortar god, trust me, right? But I think we're a pagan religion here in Clash Royale, guys. That means we worship multiple pro Clash Royale gods, at least here on CWA. And you know what? I called him the Mortar God in that video, and a lot of people in the comments were like, dude, that's Liquid Wolf. Liquid Wolf is the Mortar God. So you know what? I gotta do the right thing, and I gotta give him due respect. He finished 18th last season with Mortar, and this season he's doing very well. He's 92 at the time of this recording, but at the time of the voiceover, which is actually a day later, he's in top 30 right now, global, ultimate champion with Mortar. So definitely an incredibly good player. Today we're gonna really examine four difficult matchups, or four different types of matchups. We're gonna deal with Bait first here, then we're going to go ahead and cover Goizen deck, and then we're gonna cover what's the third one? Well, the last one is Three Musketeers. That's really, really challenging. The third one, what the heck is it? I wonder what the hog. Okay, so we're gonna cover a hog deck as the third one. So anyway, let's kind of concentrate on the gameplay here. You can see about a minute into this match, not much has really happened here. So we're gonna make a few observations about the behavior and the decision making of Liquid Wolf in all of these matches. And I guarantee, if you apply them to your own game, it's gonna make you a much better player. So the first thing to talk about with this deck, and I've showed this deck on the channel before. I should mention that with Mythja, but I haven't shown it after the balance changes. And a lot of people are asking, is Mortar dead? Is Mortar better? Is Mortar worse? And I can do only what I can do, right? So I ask the pros. I ask the pro players who I know play a lot of Mortar and a lot of Siege in general. And almost universally, take it for what it's worth. Everybody's opinion is valid here, right? But for what it's worth, all the pros have told me Mortar's basically the same. You know, it's not any worse. A little bit better in some situations, a little bit worse in some situations, but it's still just as effective. With this deck, it's almost a two-prong deck, meaning that in some matchups, like this one, you're going to be relying heavily on your Mortar. On other matchups, such as Goizen, which we're going to go ahead and review in a moment, you're going to be relying more on the bait potential of this deck. So, what do I mean by bait potential? Well, obviously, we have this deck is chock full, guys, of bait cards, right? We have Spear Goblins, Goblin Gang, Minion Horde, Skeleton Barrel. There's a lot of options for your opponent to use their poison or their zap in this deck. And if they don't have both poison and zap, man, are they really screwed. You can see we're actually doing a lot of double lane pushing too in this matchup, right? So two common themes are going to be pick your win condition that's most appropriate for your match. And number two is oftentimes split lane push or push both lanes with this deck. It is a pedal to the metal aggressive deck, right? And you need to keep track of their spells, their small spell and their big spell. So what's going to be going through your mind when you're playing this deck, guys? What spells does my opponent have and where are they in their rotation? I do want to take a moment and give a shout out to my YouTube sponsor of the day, King. Thanks for sponsoring the channel, man. I appreciate it. Moving into match number two here, this is going to be against the Goizen matchup that we talked about. Now, this is a challenging matchup where we're going to play this deck totally differently than we played the first matchup. We're going to be relying mainly on the bait of the deck and then using Mortar defensively. So you can see, first play of these matches, I've noticed one thing about Liquid Wolf's gameplay is that he does not start out with the Mortar in these matches. He oftentimes will just start out with a Knight or a Goblin Gang or just let the opponent make the first move. He's never going to start out with an aggressive Mortar. At least I haven't seen that in all the replays that I've watched from him. So take that what you will. So here we go. Playing a Goblin Gang, and the beautiful thing about this deck against Princes, against really any charge card bandit, is that even if the opponent uses a zap or a poison or whatever, we can always cycle, and with good placement of our units, we can avoid the spells, and we're always going to have a troop to distract. Now here, really good defense here, using the minion horde a little bit towards the center of the map by Liquid Wolf there to distract the other minions coming down the other lane, and then cycles to a knight there. You can just see how aggressive, Liquid Wolf is with this deck, right guys? He'll go at the bridge with just a Spear Goblins and Skeleton Barrel like we saw in the last sequence. Or, on the one we just saw, we'll see the Knight and the Goblin Gang. Basically, always trying to bait out those spells out of the opponent, and that helps him in two ways. Number one is now he can actually play defense without having to worry about the opponent having those spells in rotation. He can never be hammered with an absolutely monster push. And of course, number two is that we can be an aggressor in the other lane as well, or we can be an aggressor in the same lane after he uses his zap, knowing that he has nothing else to counter us, okay? We can even combo with a miner. So getting a few hundred more HP damage off that right tower are those Spear Goblins from the Goblin Gang. Now we have our first giant play of this match. We're gonna play the Mortar in the correct position there to distract that giant. We'll play a minion horde right on top of the Musketeer. The opponent chooses to zap there, it's okay. He sends in the miner as well. So we're gonna play a knight right in front of the princess tower. We're gonna play Spear Goblins right in front of our king tower. And look at that, guys. That was beautiful defense. And did you see the positioning of those Spirit Goblins? That's great positioning there to help. You know, Spirit Goblins have more DPS than one might think. We went pretty aggressive in the left lane. We baited out his poison. Now we just have to play a little bit of defense here. This is going to be a more challenging one here because the prince actually does make his way to the tower there. Kind of got distracted by the Spear Goblin and then went to the princess tower instead of to the mortar there. Of course, with the prince, you guys got to be careful. But here it is, guys. Check out the left lane. This is the push that really changes things. We went really hard, really aggressive in both lanes, right? And oh, his opponent, right? He didn't have enough to counter all this bait coming his way. All these small, squishy troops, they just totally overwhelmed him in both lanes. He was able to defend the right side, but not the left. And we finished things off with one swing of the shovel by the miner there on the left tower. So let's go ahead. We're back on the bottom here, guys. Kind of distracting how we're up the top and at the bottom and whatever. This time, we're going to go against the Hog deck. So this is a tricky Hog deck. It's the Hog Lumberjack deck. I shared this deck maybe last week. Really, really like it. Seeing a lot of action at the top of ladder and even some at tournament level standard as well. But it's a really good Hog deck if you guys are looking for a new meta Hog deck. I will link that video for you guys in the description below. So here we can go. We start out with a Hog counter there, and we actually do get a few little tiny hits with the skeletons on his left tower, but we know immediately what kind of deck he's playing here. So how are we going to handle this one? Obviously, we can use Mortar on defense and on offense in this matchup against Hog decks. Something to note there, right? It's not like a giant deck or a golem deck where you're really going to be saving your Mortar for just defense. You can use it both ways here against a Hog matchup. So here you can go. The opponent actually makes a good decision there, attacking the Mortar and distracting at the same time in the opposite lane with the Ice Golem there. So that was kind of an even trade. You can see again, guys, I just want to keep stressing this, right? The Liquid Wolf, he'll keep cycling these squishy troops at the bridge just to keep baiting out those counters. Again, the opponent does have poison one card away from rotation. Now it's in hand. So at this point, Liquid Wolf knows that his opponent, whatever his or her name is, has a really good hand right now against us. That's why we played the Skeleton Barrel in the back instead of the front, right? Because why would we ever play Skeleton Barrel into a zap and a poison and an ice golem. It's just not going to be good news. We know we're going to be taking some damage on this push. So we do take a few swings, from that hog, and he eats up some of that rage. So that was not too great for us. But we do counter with the miner there, and unfortunately the guards kind of stymie the rest of our troops as well, except for that one soul minion kind of staying alive. And then we cycle right back to the mortar there, knowing the opponent does not have ice golem, but does have the lumberjack in rotation. So we're gonna play again the goblin gang there. We bait out the zap out of the opponent, and we get a lock with that mortar. And that's all we really need with this deck, guys. We need, I was asking how many hits as a mortar player do you think is a win out of your mortar, right? You play your mortar, how many hits onto the tower does it need before you consider a well-played mortar? And the answer was surprisingly one, right? I mean, it costs 4 elixir. It does a lot of damage. Once you get that tower down, as you can see here against a hog deck, you can go into defensive, totally defensive mode, cycle back to another mortar, place it right there in the nick of time, and protect that tower. Even the poison's not going to finish it off. There's the poison. So that's going to be a victory for Liquid Wolf. And, you know, like I was saying, guys, one hit with the mortar is a win. You know, 2 hits, even better. 3 hits, now you're talking. And if you get that mortar that the opponent just has no answer for, no better feeling as a mortar player, even though I'm not necessarily a mortar player. It's weird, when you hate one card so much as I hate mortar, you almost make a pact with yourself. I'm just not gonna play it. I'm just not gonna play mortar. And that's kind of what I did. Anyway, we're gonna go, seeing a deck like this, it almost makes me want to, and maybe I will bust it out later on tonight. We'll see. Right now, though, I love beatdown. I love Goizen beatdown, and I love Golem beatdown, and I love that Three Musketeer deck. I think my top 3 decks right now. But of course, if you're the type of player who can play a bait deck or a mortar deck, either or, I think you'll really find this deck incredibly strong. Even in the new balance changes after, like I said, from when we last discussed it with Mistja. So here we go, we get a little bit of chip damage to start things off here, going against M-Kiz, and he is really excited about going against Liquid Wolf here. A lot of thumbs up, gives the good luck. So let's examine this, guys. 2 Musketeers, we drop the Skeleton Barrel, and then we drop the Knight in the Mortar. So remember that, guys. The 3 Musketeers are dropped by your opponent. What are you going to do? You're going to drop your Knight and your Mortar. Those are your first choices here. We dropped the Skeleton Barrel first in this circumstance, but that was only because we wanted to get the Knight and the Mortar in rotation and ready and on the arena as soon as possible. So more often than not, we're going to drop the Mortar, and then we're going to drop the Knight in the same lane as the tower with the most damage off of it for us. Now, in this matchup, you'll see something very important that I probably should have pointed out a long time ago, right? So there's no Ice Golem in this deck, and there's no Ice Spirit. So what are you combining with Zap to take out goblins and minions? Well, it's Skeleton Barrel. Against a minion horde deck, especially a 3 Musketeer minion horde deck, Skeleton Barrel and Mortar are really going to be our MVPs. We're going to be relying on Skeleton Barrel to distract the 2 Musketeer side, as well as stop the minion horde when they come down, and we combo it with Zap, and Zap and Skeleton Barrel can actually kill, as many of you know, can kill a minion or a goblin. So using the Skeleton Barrel and Zap with the death damage of the Skeleton Barrel is going to be something that we're going to be relying on heavily when using this deck. So here we go again, 3 Musketeers. So what are we going to do? Going to drop that Mortar, going to drop that Knight. And like I said, the next thing we're going to do is just wait for the opponent to do something. So we're really protecting our left lane very heavily, and then we buy some time with that Skeleton Barrel, right? So even though he had a lot coming at us in the right lane as well, we were actually really smart there, and we waited to see what he did. Oftentimes, 3 Musketeer players are waiting for you to make more moves than they do, so they know they can go all out in one of the lanes, okay? So using the Skeleton Barrel a little bit early on the 2 Musketeers side allowed us to finish things up on the left side, and then go on the counterattack and we were just able to clean up on the right with a zap. So here he comes all out in the left lane right now. So again, waiting for him to react, and then we are reacting after that. So here's the skeleton barrel, death damage, boom. Minions are no more, guys, and we don't even have to worry about that musketeer either. That was really nice defense on the left side. Check this out. On the right side, guys, we drop spear goblins. We sneak them in there. Spear goblins, after the other spear goblins died from the goblin gang, and all of a sudden, we are right back in this with 766 HP on the right tower. Now, this time, we're predicting this battle ram. We had a really nice knight and a really nice goblin gang there. Now, we just have to kill this miner before he gets too much damage onto our tower and we can't recover. We bait out the zap from the opponent there, and now it's 271 HP on our tower. But we know there's no zap in the opponent's hand, and that was what this deck is all about, guys. That zap is gone. We use zap and the miner. Even the ice golem isn't going to be enough to kill all our swarm units left because we forced out the zap on defense. And that is how you win against three musketeers, against one of the better three musketeer players out there in the game. So guys, I hope you enjoyed this video. Huge shout out to Liquid Wolf for coming on, and of course to Bren Zhang, my YouTube partner. Check out his information in the description below. Guys, thanks so much for watching, and as always, take care, guys.